thyroid glands are compound tubuloacinar merocrine exocrine glands. Exocrine is where the secretion is thrown out through ductal system. And tubuloacinar, this having a tubular pattern and acinar pattern, it is a multilobular ductal system. So this is their organization. They are having the serous acini, they have different ducts which are present. The serous acini, the mucous acini, the myoepithelial cells are present. Serous deminules are there. Different ducts like intercalated duct, the striated duct which are part of the infralobular duct and interlobular duct which is the collecting duct. Now how do these develop? They basically develop from the oral epithelium, from the oral mucosa. Bud formation is the first stage where induction of the oral epithelium by the underlying mesenchyme. Now once this formation occurs, it grows down. Similar to the dental lamina, it grows down like an epithelial cord and there is initiation of the branching, then it branches out in the terminal parts of the epithelial cord and condensation of the glandular differentiation occurs. Later in the fourth stage, there is a dichotomous branching. The branching of the epithelial cord is uniform and these branching further get canalized, which are going to be the presumptive ducts. And in the final stage of salivary gland development, you have the histodifferentiation of the functional acini and the intercalated ducts. So through this five-stage mechanism, you have the development of the salivary glands. We all know about the major salivary glands. We're not going to go into anatomy of it. You have learned a lot of anatomy on Monday. So we are going to look into only the histology part. Parotid glands, they are purely serous. Submandibular glands are predominantly serous. Sublingual glands are predominantly mucus. And we know that these glands have ducts to open. Like Stenson's duct is the duct of the opening of the duct. It is 7 cm long of the parotid gland. The submandibular gland opens by the Watkins duct, which is 5 cm long. And the sublingual gland opens by the way of the Bartholin's duct, which is also called as the diaphragmus duct. So when you talk about the minor salivary glands, now you have the glands which are present in the labial mucosa, which are mixed, predominantly mucus. Buccal mucosa, again predominantly mucus. Glossopalatine fold, you have some which are purely mucus. Lingual are the anterior gland in none, which are mucus. Circumvallar papillae, the Von Ebner's glands are purely serous. And the posterior salivary glands present in the tongue are also purely mucus. Palatine glands which are present on the hard and soft palate are also purely mucus. So we are seeing how the structure is. The series of branch ducts terminating in spherical or tubular emphysis or acini. And here we can see they basically have principally two different types of cells. The luminal cells and the non-luminal cells. The luminal cells, these are the secretory cells, basically the acini and the lining cells in the ductal system. The non-luminal cells are the myoepithelial cells and the basal cells. Others are present in the connective tissue. Which are these cells present in the connective tissue? You have fibroblasts, you have lymphocytes, plasma cells, nerve cells, adipose cells, and the fat cells. So we are basically going to look into the secretory cells. The two main types are the serous cells and the mucous cells. So these cells of the serous type are similar to the pancreatic cells. They're 8 to 12 in number. They have a central lumen. The lumen is small. The cells are pyramidal in shape. They have a broad base, as you can see in the picture, which is adjacent to the connective tissue stroma, and they have a narrow apex which is forming part of the lumen at the end piece. The spherical nuclei are located basally and occasionally binucleated cells are seen. This is how the structure is. You can see the lot of secretory granules which are there. A large round ovoid nuclei which is present at the base. You can see the rough endoplasmic reticulum, and since it is a active cell, secretory cells, you can also see the other active cells. Then you also have some micromilli which can be seen on the luminal surfaces, and the basal surface you can see it is thrown into regular folds and they extend laterally beyond the borders of the cell to interdigitate with the adjacent cells. So that's how through these extensions they are in interdigitation with the adjacent cells. Also these cells are attached to each other with the different junctions that we talked about in the oral mucous membrane, that is zonal occludens, zonal adherens and zonal desmosomes, that is macular adherence. The tight junctions, they help to maintain the cell surface domain. They regulate the passage of material from the lumen to the intercellular spaces. They have a selective permeability. They allow the passage of certain ions in water. The secretory cells also attach to the basal lamina and the underlying connective tissue by the hemidesmosomes. Then you have the mucous cells. The mucous cells are basically triangular in shape, and they contain numerous droplets of mucin. typically they have a tubular configuration, and you can see that they are tubules are more tubular as round profiles of mucous cells surrounding a central lumen of large size with that of the serous end pieces. Now, mucous end pieces have a serous cell associated with them in the form of a demi-nule, and this is called as a serous demi-nule. You can see it is crescent shape that is covering the mucous cells at the end of the tubules. Most prominent feature of mucous cells is accumulation in the apical cytoplasm of the large amount of secretory product which compress the nucleus and the endoplasmic reticulum against the basal cell membrane. So you can see the nucleus is flat. It is actually very flat and it is present at the base. So there are some differences which you should remember between the serous anseri and the mucous S9. What are these? The size of serous S9, they are smaller, the lumen is narrow, they are pyramidal in shape, of course, like mucous S9, but the nucleus is round, it is centrally positioned, it has electron-dense zymosin granules and less number of microtubule cells, and the secretion is basically watery and rich in enzymes. But there's the mucous S9, they are larger, they are wider, they have a flat nucleus which is towards the base, they have electrolucent mucin granules and n number of microtubule cells, and they secrete a thick or viscous fluid which is rich in glycoproteins. Myofibril cells is another important cell. They are contractile cells associated with the secretory end pieces and interconnected ducts of the salivary glands. And these cells are most prominent feature of mucous cells is accumulation at the apices. And what is the function of these cells? They're basically said to be basket cells. They are also having, like the muscle cells, they also have contractile filaments like actin, soluble myosin is present. And these cells, when they compress the S9, the saliva which is secreted is usually thrown out. That is one of the functions. They say that the expulsion of the primary saliva from the NPs into the ductal system, this is brought about by the contraction of the myofibril cells. And these are the ducts which are present. You have intralobular ducts and you have the interlobular ducts. So what are the interlobular ducts? Interconnected ducts, single layer cuboidal cells, secretory units may also secrete lysosome and lactoferrin. The striated ducts, they constitute columnar cells, they're the largest portion of the ductal system, as you can see here. The more larger portion is by these type of the cells, the striated ducts, they modify the primary saliva by reabsorption and secretion of the electrolytes. That is their basic function. And ultimately, you have the terminal excretory ducts, which are pseudostratified columnar epithelium. The other cells which are present are tough cells, lymphocytes, macrophages, which may be present. So this is how you have the appearance of the various components of the salivary gland, where you have the S9 pattern, the luminal cells, the non-luminal cells, the nitric cells, and the ductal cells, which can be seen in this picture. And the non-luminal cells are basically the myoepithelial cells. So what are the functions of the salivary ducts? They convey the primary saliva secreted by the terminal secretory units through the oral cavity. They actively modify the primary saliva by secretion and absorption of the electrolytes and secretion of the proteins. The interconnected duct cells secrete two antibacterial enzymes, that is lysozyme and lactoferrin. Now the connective tissue which is present, it includes the surrounding capsule. And basically, these connective tissue divides the serous S9 into lobes. So you can see their lobular system, which we can see. The capsule is divided into lobes, and then the blood vessels and nerve supply is supplying the parenchymal components. Now there are some age changes which can be seen. There's a generalized loss of salivary gland parenchymal tissue as age advances. There's a gradual reduction of up to 30% to 60% in the proportional acinar volume of the major salivary gland. There's loss of these salivary cells are replaced by the adipose tissue. There's increase in the fibrous tissue and the vascular elements. Apart from this, there are different diseases which can occur in the salivary gland, like local or systemic, maybe from mumps. All of you must have suffered from mumps when you were a child, like both your cheeks become plumpy with this viral infection. And as a person advances in age, there may be endocrine, autoimmune, infectious, genetic diseases which may be present.